I am also 100% behind the idea that black people, as the victims, must determine their own destiny. You can never let the oppressor decide the pace for you, because if you let the oppressor decide the pace, then you'll always be in a trip.
The field of psychology, when I first started in the in undergrad in the 60s and then in grad school in 72, just pathologized our people. And it was really because they didn't understand our cultural frame. Very individually focused. They did not understand collective identity. They interpreted our differences as deficits. And I think without a culturally relevant framework, you have those kinds of errors.
Most of the research on blacks were done by whites, and overrepresentation of black children was placed in special education, that black kids were being misplaced in too large a proportion, and mostly black males were being placed in special education. It really demeaned black students.
We're learning about these theories of black folks based upon this notion of cultural deprivation and cultural pathology and deficiencies of one kind or another. The literature was saying that a major problem for black children was they come from environments that are overstimulated. Too much stimulation is going on in these houses. It leads them to be hyperactive and not be able to have good attention spans and the likes. You know, we need to put some labels on these things that we're observing. And I said, and we can't just use the old labels because people will interpret things from that mainstream perspective. So I said, we need new labels, and we have to have the power to define. It's not that there's overstimulation. These kids come from verbistic environments. That what you're seeing is not hyperactivity, you're seeing behavioral verve. These kids are living in lively environments and they have a preference for high-level stimulation, so that's psychological verve. So maybe if we begin looking at ways, not how these kids have learning disabilities because of their environment, but how teachers have instructional disabilities because they don't know how to take advantage of these cultural assets that our children bring with them into the learning environment.
It was the same conversation all the time. We were dissatisfied with traditional white psychology, the invisibility and the deficit deficiency model. So no matter where we started, that's where we always ended up in the conversation. And then we said we have to build a psychology of our own since we can't depend upon our oppressors to define us in a strength-based way. We would have to define ourselves.
If you sample the universe of African-American people, much like scholars like Joe White and others argue, that if you're going to develop a black psychology, that it ought to emerge out of the authentic experiences of black folk in America. But the question becomes, if I sample that whole universe of black folk in America, am I really sampling what is normal and healthy and indigenous to the culture? Or is what I'm sampling ways in which black folk have adapted to 350 to 400 years of this craziness in America? And nowadays, unlike my earlier years, I argue the latter rather than the former.
I started out looking for what was making black people mentally ill and was focused on racism and then the need to understand, and I still am in that position. In other words, it is racism, white supremacy as a global system that is responsible for everything that is happening to us.
For over 100 years, the mind of the citizen has not been freed. Do you feel that this is the root cause of the Negro problem?
We feel it is a very important cause. The attitude of the society generally, of white people, and unfortunately of some black people, is that black people are inferior and should in fact occupy an inferior status in this society.
The primary problem at this point is black-white, but I think it's really much deeper than that. It goes to the heart of the white man's psyche, where he thinks and feels that he indeed is superior to other people, and this has to stop. At this point, the country has reached a very desperate crisis where most black people are saying, either give it to us or blow up the system. And I don't think America at this point has the luxury to sit around and decide. I think with all deliberate speed, which means right now, these grievances must be redressed. Black people must be brought in as black Americans into the American family with all the rights and privileges and all the psychological rights and privileges that accrue to them.
What is black psychology? Black psychology is looking at the perceptions, values, worldview from the perspective of black folks as they articulate it. So that we didn't discover black psychology in the 60s, it was already there. But we articulated it from the perspective of the folks themselves. We wanted to give them their own voice. Whereas prior to that time, that voice was invisible in psychology, or it was deficit deficiency, low IQ, poor impulse control, can't delay gratification, can't do a complex task. So the story had been told from outside, and we wanted to tell it from inside out.
Black psychology is part of what we would call the Black Studies movement. The Black Studies movement is a movement to capture the experience of a particular people, in this case, people of African descent. It's, in terms of psychology, it's an attempt to be that strand of Black Studies that focuses on the psychology of a people, in this case, people of African descent. It is a movement that's part reactionary, part proactive. Reactionary in the sense that mainstream psychology and mainstream cultural studies either did not pay much attention to the black experience, or even worse, tended to scaffold it in pejorative terminology and results. So it's both a correction, but it's also an affirmation. It's no accident that it eventually evolved into something called African psychology, because some of the people who are concerned with the study of black people are also concerned with going back in time and space and seeing the connection to our ultimate roots.
Now, black psychology, I think of as having begun in reaction to what we had learned about identifying who we were. And when I say what we had learned as captives within a Euro-American, a European frame of reference, a European definition of what was reality, what was real, and what it meant to be human. And so our introduction to psychology then was reacting to that. So we had to kind of deconstruct that. And that deconstruction says, okay, we must no longer see ourselves as we were defined by this other perspective, which is not our own perspective. And therefore, we need to identify it as a perspective that, in fact, identifies who we are. So it became a kind of a liberation. Two, how do we kind of free the captives from this alien perspective of defining themselves?
May I say something to you to give you a true knowledge of yourself and life so that the same glory and success attained by other men who understand themselves may be yours? So there is no excuse for the black man in lacking the knowledge that man is used to beautify the world and produce all that he needs for his happiness and civilization. If you are able to live with the knowledge of yourself and with the greater knowledge of nature, you must know what is good and what is not.
It's a spectrum. On one side of the spectrum is Africa. And then a writer has to decide how deep he wants to go into the foundation of Africa to understand these brothers in Oakland today. And some go all the way back to ancient Egypt. And some pick it up more when we come here to the States. But it's all part of one model, I'd say, that has different variations.
My black psychology also has a cultural component, because it's only from the cultural grounding of what I call the wisdom tradition of African deep thought that that conception of black makes sense. So African psychology would be inclusive of black psychology based on my definition, but African psychology, I think in most people's mind's eye, again, speaks to a particular cultural orientation, of which my definition could be a part.
Black psychology within Ed Vane generally refers to psychology related to the African-American experience in some camps of the black psychology community. And African-American psychology, of course, you know, would be used interchangeably with that usage of black psychology. Of course, African psychology, the way I use it, has a global scope, you know, in terms of ethnicity and racial application.
The further you go back into the African experience or the African ethos, the more you are trying to find a source of original strengths and values that did not emanate from the American experience. So while the American experience is long, it's rich, it has its strengths, but the original values and foundations of people of African descent who live in America came from Africa.
In my work, I actually combine the terms black and African, or I link them. So I use African slash black psychology to indicate that I'm not only referring to the psychological experience of African Americans or the psychological experience of North Americans, but the psychological experience of diasporan Africans as well as continental Africans, understanding that there may be some contextual variation and even some philosophical variation because of the context, but at the core that the, you know, the worldview principles would be relatively the same.
As we move from kind of deconstructing that paradigm or deconstructing those assumptions to begin to reconstruct how it was we defined ourselves before our captivity, I think the way that we identified that reconstruction process was to call it African psychology. So I don't like to think of it as being antithetical. I simply see it as being the evolution. It's the older brother, the older sister. It's the a more matured perspective of what began as a kind of a reactive form that came to be a kind of a reconstructing of defining ourselves for ourselves from our own ontological perspective.
To me, African psychology was about essentially a cultural war. Cultural war is an ideological struggle where we are literally at war for the minds and hearts and the future of our people. And so the development of the discipline of African psychology really became a cultural war of ideology. It became a cultural war of self-determination, where we as African psychologists determined to chart our own future rather than just following the footsteps of our colleagues in European American psychology. It was a cultural war of values, and that were the values that are central to African psychology going to read the footsteps that we followed, as opposed to embracing someone else's cultural ideology in European and Western psychology. And it was also a war of cultural relevance. The African psychology was fundamentally about cultural relevance and whether or not we could develop a psychology that was relevant to the people. And that, to me, is what was important.
If you look at psychology, I mean, and we say black psychology, some people call, say, Saku. I mean, when we look at these concepts, when we go backwards in terms of our history to sort of find a standing place, what we discover is that the African people had already developed many notions of the mind long before we encountered the West. before the Greeks came to these notions of the mind, particularly concepts that they came out with like logos and pathos and ethos and so forth, that Africa had at its root notions such as Mat, for example, Sarujta. I mean, many notions that were very basic. And if we could grapple with those notions and understand those notions, we would have some understanding.
The African psychology is the only psychology that the first attempt by human beings to understand the spirit and human functioning was done in ancient Kemet, or what people call Egypt.
Most of the major ethnic groups from the Senegal River in the north to the Congo River in the south can trace their origins to the Nile Valley, beginning about 650 BC or thereabouts, when the first of five migrations left the Nile Valley, moving westward into Western Africa. So that when you look at ethnic groups that we are familiar with, whether it be the Wolof and the Lebu of Senegal, whether it be the Akan of Ghana, whether it be the Ewe of Togo or the Fon of Benin or the Yoruba of Nigeria, all of them and others can trace their origins back to the Nile Valley. That means they can trace their systems, their spiritual systems. You might even say their psychological systems and mythical systems and symbolic systems also back to the Nile Valley.
And as we go back and then reclaim some of that African culture and begin to study and embrace some of the ideology that came out of those ancient Kemetic and historically African places, what we know is that our discipline of psychology is really thousands of years old, not just, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50, or even 100 years old. And in fact, traverses a landscape from historical contemporary times all the way back even into ancient Kemetic spaces.
Way later on, several thousand years later, Europeans began to talk about a psychology, and which really was an armchair philosophy that later on became, with Wundt, became based on laboratory, and it became, quote, scientific psychology. But all that is very recent. The original psychology was in ancient Egypt, or ancient Kemet, by black people.
It was also the ancient Kemetic Egyptians, those indigenous peoples of Africa, who came down the Nile and created that civilization. They also not only knew about the unconscious mind, they also knew about the superconscious mind, the mind that is above the unconscious mind and subsumes the conscious mind. And they mapped it out in exquisite detail. If you look at the clinical work and also the scholarship of both Freud and Jung, they mention this in different ways.
Jung investigated the concept of what he called the collective unconscious, where everything in the spiritual life of human beings takes place, and it fuels everything that happens in the conscious world. And it connects to all of what he called the mythical and symbolic constructs that human beings have created over the millennia, so that all religion, all symbolism, all mythology, all derives from the actions of the collective unconscious. So that's the reason why Jung, and to a lesser extent Freud, were fascinated by the psychomythic systems of traditional and tribal peoples.
And if you look at both of those and what they're talking about and their own statements about it, it brings you inevitably back to the ancient Kemetic Egyptians who studied the unconscious and called it by name.
To the extent that you're talking about a black psychology based on systems, cosmological systems, world systems that are in West Africa, ultimately these are ancient Kemetic systems once removed. So that when you think about any African system today, it all ramifies back to ancient Kemet.
The ancient Kemetic Egyptians outlined that the world was basically alive. Each individual consciousness was part of a much larger web, and that this web continued to transform itself. The whole art and science of mummification, the basis of that was the not only the belief, but the perception and the experience that consciousness transforms itself, not only from the waking state to the dreaming state, but also to the postmortem state.
The pyramids were actually designed by priests. They were designed by people whose study was of the soul. In fact, there is a huge scene
on in the pyramids. It's called the psychostasis. And the psychostasis is that scene that some of you know about where you have the initiate being judged by the netters or by the gods and the weighing of his heart in the against the feather of Ma'at. That is an ancient scene. It's called the psychostasis. And in that scene, the interpretation of it is that man or woman must go through a judgment of their righteousness. And when they are found wanting, they have to be taught the right way. And the right way is what we call therapy. I have made the argument that that scene was called the Saku. And the Saku is really the word that was bastardized by the Greeks to become the psyche. And the psyche becomes a study of the spirit or psychology, but it really was Saku, which was the illumination of the spirit. And in illuminating the human spirit, one was able to understand the transitions and the transformations of humanity.
And so in African psychology, what we have tried to do is go back across space and time. Space meaning what is central to North Africa, Central, South, West, and East Africa. Across time, meaning what is consistent in ancient, Kemetic, historically African, and contemporary African-American spaces that allow us as Black psychologists to go back and reclaim some of those traditions and customs and worldview that are part and parcel of our own cultural tradition. And that, to me, is where African psychology has evolved and what it represents today as a series of constructs and principles that are more consistent with an African-centered ideology.
In the European psychological tradition, the human being is defined with reference to their internal psychological attributes, such as their thoughts and emotions. In other words, the goal of becoming a human being then is to individuate, is to separate from other people and find who you are internally and define yourself independently of your surroundings. Now, this differs markedly from an indigenous African psychological perspective, whereby the goal of becoming a human being is to find connections. The goal of becoming a human being is to respond to the energies that are always surrounding you, the vibrations that are out there are an indication that we are all connected to other people.
African psychology is basically a perspective that looks at human beings within the context of how Africans understood the human experience.
I would define African psychology as a system of knowledge encompassing constructs, concepts, paradigms, models, systems of practice, procedures for conduct, etc., a way of knowing the world in reality from the perspective or the vantage point are grounded in African-American culture reality and African culture reality.
African psychology is a way of thinking that is centered in an African worldview. It's essentially the dynamic manifestation of unifying African principles, values, and traditions. Because African psychology says that what makes you a human being is much more than what is proposed in the biopsychosocial model of Western thought.
African psychology begins to build on some of the basic assumptions about the nature of life, the nature of the human being, that is, in fact, indigenous to African people categorically.
So when we think about African-centered psychology, it has certain principles. For example, it recognizes that spirit permeates everything. The notion that everything in the universe is interconnected. The idea that the value of the collective is much more important than the individual. It is not, I think, therefore I am. It is, I am because we are.
And we talk about African psychology, but we are talking about it from not within the system, but out from outside the system and looking at it. So when you start examining not merely the historical framework of ancient African history, but their mythological, spiritual, and symbolic framework, you see that they established those parameters in a way that impacted the rest of the world from then on.
The term psychology was in fact a derivation of psyche, which was in fact a recognition that the psyche was the soul, and that the study of the soul was the original agenda of what the discipline of psychology was all about.
So psychology is just, you might say, it's not just a way of thinking. It's not just mental, whether it's conscious or unconscious. It's a way of being. Now, if you understand it as a way of being, then you begin to get at the essence of what people like to think of as African psychology, which is really what you might call African spiritual systems, or the African world systems is what I like to say.
There are a number of principles that guide spiritual and human existence in the African universe. These principles include the principle of mutuality and complementarity, or those of insufficiency and interdependence. The notion of the factor of incompleteness is used to draw attention to a framework of insufficiency that I believe characterizes the nature of beings in the universe. Nothing in the universe, whether spirits or human beings, can exist on their own in isolation from the others. A human being cannot be defined from an indigenous African psychological perspective with reference to their psychological attributes only, because that is just a very, very small element of what it means to be human. To be human has to be explained with reference to the idea of ubuntu. Umuntu ngumuntu ngabantu. A human being is a human being because of other human beings.
The concept of ubuntu is translated and explained in different ways. Some people say it means I am because you are. But it also means that I am part of a collective. It means reciprocity. It means I will act to you the way you act to me. It means mutuality, people help each other. So to develop an African psychology is a necessity, because it talks to the cultural experiences of the people. And cultural African psychology is very strong in then talking to these experiences that might be missed in Western psychology.
So the idea of Ubuntu then says that you belong in the first instance to your own family, you belong to the community, you belong to your ancestors, and ultimately you are part of the broader universe.
There are interpenetrating realms of existence. In other words, there's the mundane world of the physical and our current manifestation as human beings, but there's also another realm of existence at the spiritual realm, and that is as real as the mundane world, and that these two worlds interact with each other. These two worlds serve functions and purposes. These two worlds need to be in harmony. And nothing in life, including the human and the spirit, lives in isolation from one another. So we are coexisting, and we are always in connection to each other.
There are three interrelated and interpenetrating worlds that constitute the universe. Among these three worlds are the following: the world above, or the sky world, the world beneath, or the spirit world, and the in-between world, or what is also called the human world, the earthly world. This belief of the intermingling of forces in the human world is also responsible for prayers, for religious rituals, for religious ceremonies. There are so many means by which human beings can communicate or contact the various realms of the universe, according to the African cosmology.
Well, you might say there is a seamless cosmic connection, which now encompasses everything on Earth, everything in the heavens, and indeed the entire universe. The universe is a fabric, and everything in it is kind of connected to everything else.
So at the core of African psychology, at the core of Ubuntu, is the unity of being, that we are all one in spirit.
My argument is that Afrocentricity is a theory that gives African people the conceptual framework from which to discuss and analyze and to critique almost all of phenomena related to African people.
What makes Africa so essential to our understanding of humanity is the fact that that's the only place that we can find the historical foundation for all human culture and civilization. So if we're going to be comprehensive in our orientation, we absolutely have to go back to Africa.
Africa is the mother continent. Africa is the continent where everyone originated, and it is there that people stood up and started asking critical questions about life. Those are questions such as, who am I? What is my relationship to other people, and what is my relationship to the natural environment?
African thought says there are other ways to generate knowledge. There are other ways through which we get information. For example, there's preter-rational knowledge, knowledge that goes beyond logic, it goes beyond rational thought. And that preter-rational knowledge means that I have the ability in my consciousness to access other realms of information that can come to me through dreams, it can come to me through intuition, it can come to me through the ancestors, it can come to me through divination, it can come to me through what we call daimonic thinking. Basically, that there are other ways of gathering information, knowing at the level beyond your senses.
The Sangoma or traditional healer will try and establish where has the person's community gone wrong in terms of their connection between the family and the ancestors. So we'll try and establish where has relatedness been broken.
We think of going beyond the information given. We think of going beyond the ordinary crisis the individual is facing to think about, is there something that is beyond our eyes? They try to involve the Sangoma in South Africa or the Dibiafa, if it is among the Igbo, to go into divination, to ask, to find out from the ancestors. Because human beings live in a precarious environment populated by invisible spiritual agencies.
Human beings are primarily spiritual beings. That is a fundamental tenet that goes all the way back to Nile Valley civilization, and it is consistent through every culture of Africa.
We actually walk in the world as unique and valuable spirits vibrating in seven different directions. So we don't just walk forward and back, we vibrate in seven different directions.
This is why music is so important. This is why the rhythm is so important, because rhythm and music and dance function to change the vibration of the participants. These vibrations are a way of connecting with your personal deity, as well as the group deity, as the collective deity, as well as the overall overarching creator from which all things come.
The vibrating in seven different directions may have some import for understanding what kinds of dysfunctional rhythms may need to be addressed.
So it is through the means of not only knowing the vibrations, but feeling the vibrations, enacting the vibrations, that certain kinds of human beings can, as it were, be in touch with beings of another order.
In a pictorial way, when we watch how Black people dance, we actually dance, in most of our dances are in seven directions. We may not realize that the tribal dance of moving in seven different directions, vibrating in seven different directions, is the medicine of the balm that makes us well, at least strong enough to go back and deal with the crises that are in our community. But we haven't looked at ourselves as this African conceptualization of what it means to be a human being. When we start doing that, we start seeing the world differently. And then then go to the club and watch Black folk do what we do. Or watch the African drummers and see how their beats really give us the impression that feels like, well, I'm backing up, or you know, I'm doing all these dance. These things are the important things for us to look at, because it makes sense once you understand the African meaning of what it means to be a human being. What is real is my spirit. And that spirit is a knowing and knowable trifold vibrating, radiating spirit. And so part of what we are now talking about as psychology is knowing what our spirit knows, being able to talk to our spirit, being able to understand where that vibrating, radiating energy that we call spirit becomes chaotic. When I get disconnected or shattered, then I see chaotic rhythm. And that chaotic rhythm is best what we call insanity.
That's what trans states are designed to do. You get opened up to the deity. And that deity comes down and inhabits you and displaces your personality for that period of time. Because very often the deities will communicate with the community through the individuals that they possess. Second of all, the individual himself or herself might induce possession for reasons that have to do with what he or she needs, particularly in the realm of healing. And then thirdly, it's just a way to bring the deity into the community through possession. And when that happens, the person who is possessed loses all sense of him or herself, has no consciousness of what is happening while it's happening, and when the possession ends, has no memory of it. Because personality and spirit, it has been displaced, you might say, by that of the descending spirit or deity.
It has a way of psychologically cleansing you. That's one of the ways in which they treat psychological illness, what we get to call psychological illness.
The way that Africans understand psychological development is a process of transformation, where you become gradually transformed so that you can become an affirmation of that spiritual being that you came here to be. So the idea is that we are in a journey, and the life experience, the physical life experience, is in fact a transition, and it's a period of transformation from spirit back to spirit.
As I read all of the personality theories, none really apply to Black people. That is, everything the researchers said about Black people related to the deficit model, that Black people had deficit personalities compared to whites on all of the psychological testing. So none of them had the basis of African psychology, of philosophy. So I felt that what we really needed to do was develop an Afrocentric description of Black personality.
There's something psychological about African descent people deeply rooted in our souls, in our systems, in terms of its cultural content, you know, its spirituality. No matter where we are on planet Earth, there's this Africanity within us. And you find them in African people in North America, in Australia, in India, Southeast Asia, wherever you find African people, you find these various ways of approaching, you know, adaptability.
So in 1981, I wrote the book on the collective Black mind, saying that we are a collective people. We have a collective community, collective philosophy, and that's the framework from which we should derive personalities of Black people. The collective Black mind is based on a concept of cultural bonding, groupness, togetherness, and African philosophy of the ethos, I am because you are, and because you are, therefore I am. I did not want to use white cultural terminology in developing this. I wanted to introduce African concepts such as Afrotyping, which means these are typical Black concepts, Black behavior, Afrocizing, how kids can be brought up in an African-centered culture. So instead of using self-concept, I use WEUSI, we, W-E-U-S-I, meaning that we is the outstanding part of this personality theory, then us and I. In other words, the individual is really third on the list.
I wanted to capture this Africanity as a part of understanding the motivational system behind African-American behavior. I had invented this construct called African self-extension orientation. I was trying to refer to this elasticity, this fluidity of the African spirit, how it moves at a spiritual level, and how this energy in African people is always trying to extend itself beyond the physical boundaries of the individual to connect with other individuals or the collective of individuals. And so it had to have a genetic property in my thinking, because it was something that was fundamental to African descent people. The second construct in the model of called African self-consciousness, I saw as necessary to explain what I call the efficacious functioning in a more African-centered way of the motivation in African-American behavior. A third aspect of the theory was to explain abnormality, deviance in our behavior. So I introduced this construct called culture misorientation, given the reality of contemporary African behavior, you know, in terms of the manifestations of the trauma that we see in almost every aspect of our existence. And culture misorientation essentially means the internalization of a European worldview or European consciousness in African descent people, which leads them to approach life, to approach adaptability in the world from the basis of a Eurocentric conception of that universe.
Who taught you to hate the texture of your hair? Who taught you to hate the color of your skin to such extent that you bleach to get like the white man? Who taught you to hate the shape of your nose and the shape of your lips? Who taught you to hate yourself from the top of your head to the soles of your feet? Who taught you to hate your own kind? Who taught you to hate the race that you belong to? So much so that you don't want to be around each other.
We have internalized an incorrect cultural orientation. It leads us to engage in behaviors that are maladaptive for an African person in terms of these behaviors. While they may lead to accommodation with the reality and environment that we're in, they don't lead to African empowerment.
The explanation of the widespread acceptance of Christianity may lie in the history of Ankole's contact with the outside world. For much that is of non-African origin was introduced by the churches. Thus, in many respects, to be civilized or modern means to many Africans to be Christian. But even if we understand the factors contributing to the general acceptance of Christianity and other non-African concepts, the problem remains of explaining the different degrees of acceptance characteristic of different individuals. What kinds of personality traits, what kinds of individual experiences contribute to the process whereby one person does or does not adopt a new behavior pattern? This is the kind of question current psychological research in rapidly changing societies attempts to answer.
African self-consciousness, core of our personality, because it is socialized, is vulnerable to cultural modification. So it can be modified from its natural state by the institutional bombardment of Eurocentrism. And so what happens is that we develop an alien self-consciousness that's sort of superimposed upon our natural African self-consciousness. If our natural African self-consciousness is not being reinforced through socialization structures that are natural to African-centered reality, what we have is something similar to what W.B. Du Bois talked about in his dual consciousness construct. Two forces, these two motivational forces, one Eurocentric and one African-centric.
It's kind of like what James Baldwin talked about, and he says, for white America, basically, success means how quickly I become white. And when you have that as your standard, you can never be whole, because we're never going to be white, nor should we have to be white. We need to defy the lie of white superiority and black inferiority. For far too long, we've been operating from a Eurocentric paradigm. This paradigm has false claims about universality, and it has false claims about objectivity. It reflects an aggressive seizure of intellectual space. It has short-circuited creativity. It has led to the negation, the obliteration, the marginalization of the African presence in the world, of African meaning, of the significance of African activities. And it has led to kind of an inferiorization of African people, such that it is hard for us to just be us and do us.
This brother here, myself, all of us were born with our hair like this, and we just wear it like this because it's natural, because the reason for it, you might say, is like a new awareness among black people that their own natural appearance, its physical appearance, is beautiful. I felt it was a purpose. It was a special purpose. More so a meaning for me to be natural.
Wearing my natural, it like shows within me. It gives me more pride within myself.
For so many, many years, we were told that only white people were beautiful. Only straight hair, light eyes, light skin was beautiful. And so black women would try everything they could, straighten their hair, lighten their skin, to look as much like white women. But this has changed because black people are aware now that their own appearance is beautiful. They're proud of it. Dig it? Isn't it beautiful? All right.
There it goes. The fourth atomic bomb has been successfully detonated. First you see a blinding flash.
It is very arrogant to assume that you could give a paper and pencil test to any human being, black or white, and measure the capability for someone to learn. And that's what IQ is about. The Army Alpha test and the Army Beta test, which were in the 1917 era, 1916 era, World War I, were the first tests of this nature. Those tests were touted as being the science of IQ testing at that time. The results of that test, of course, placed disenfranchised people at the bottom of the totem pole, because the items were comprised of those experiences of the middle-class majority world. It became a very simple and easy task for the psychologists to get a population of white children and a population of black children, administer some tests of some sort, compare the two, and have done some research. And of course, you would know who would be on the short end of that research, because it was using a yardstick that had not taken into consideration the normalization data or standardization data involving black Americans or other minority groups.
Leon Kamen, who wrote the book, The Science and Politics of IQ, talked about the pure racism that existed and how the whole notion was to demonstrate racial inferiority of minorities.
The creator of the Stanford BNA, Lewis Terman, had very interesting political ideas, especially racist ideas about black people and other people. And for example, he said no amount of education would ever make us capable voters or good citizens. And he not only had that view, but was associated with a whole body of psychologists at the time who belonged to groups like the Human Breeders Association, who believed in social Darwinism, that it was their job to purify the races and to get rid of the dumb people. And they had something called the Eugenics Research Association, and many of the prominent psychologists of the time belonged to the Eugenics Research Association. So that's political. That's not just, you know, it's not just educational. That's making political choices about who lives and who doesn't. For example, sterilizations were conducted in California based on the use of IQ tests. Tests are used to determine what kind of course you get to take in school, the curriculum that you're going to be offered. An IQ test is sometimes used in the criminal justice system to determine whether you're going to go on parole or not. An IQ test determines whether you go to college or not, whether you get a scholarship or not, whether you will be an officer or an enlisted man in the Army or not, whether you will move into management or into something else in the corporate world. In other words, there are many, many uses of IQ tests as a gatekeeping device.
Dear Mr. and Mrs. Evans, as you can see by the enclosed mark of the IQ aptitude test, your son scores among the lowest in the school. Based on his score, it's my advice that instead of an academic career, your son enroll in a trade school.
So in the educational system, there were two categories, trainable and educable mentally retarded. It turned out that there were three times as many blacks in the educably mentally retarded classes, as would be expected by their enrollment in the district. But there was less than one-third as many blacks would be expected to be placed in the gifted classes than would be expected by their enrollment numbers. So in other words, IQ scores put people in and kept people out.
And get this question. A mother, father, and two children live in a five-bedroom residence. The mother and father sleep in one bedroom, and each of the two children has a room to himself. Mm. How many guest bedrooms are there left? Now, how many kids in the ghetto even know what a guest bedroom is?
And how many of them even heard the word residence?
That's right. To them, it's a pad or crib.
Now, what you're trying to say then, Michael, is it's hard to give the right answers when you don't understand the questions, huh?
That's right, Daddy. And, Daddy, white students didn't do so good when they took the black intelligence test.
Oh, now, Thelma, you know there ain't no such thing as a black intelligence test.
Yes, there is, Ma. It was made up by a black psychologist. And when he gave the test to white students, they scored 35 points lower than black students.
I had almost been a casualty of intelligence testing. I had scored 82 on an IQ test, and my counselor told me that I should go into special ed or into a vocational trade program. So I developed a black intelligence test to show all of those questions were culturally biased because no black kids had been included in that sample. In fact, the author said that he intentionally left black kids out. The same thing with the early WISC. There were no black kids included in that sample. So therefore, I developed a culturally specific test, which I call the Black Intelligence Test of Cultural Homogeneity. The acronym is the BITCH test, meaning that testing is difficult and a culture-specific test was easier for black people than for other races. I administered to whites and blacks. Whites did not understand any of the items. They scored very low on it.
There's a Mr. and Mrs. Evans here to see you. They don't have an appointment, but they're very anxious to speak with you.
Well, send them in. What can I do for you?
Oh, our son brought this letter home. It's a result of his IQ test.
Ah, yes. I recommended trade school, yeah. Oh, your son's score was low.
The reason our son failed that jive test is because it wasn't fair to blacks.
It isn't fair to Chicanos, Indians, Puerto Ricans. It isn't fair to any minorities.
Now, that's impossible. You see, all our intelligent quotient tests are scientifically computerized to accurately determine the intellectual potential of each student. I mean, it's infallible.
With all those statistics in your head, you must have a high IQ.
Yes.
Well, I guess it'd be easy for you to pass an IQ test, huh?
Oh, yes, yes. I feel quite safe in saying that it would be.
Well,
yes.
Then... Mm-hmm. I suppose it wouldn't be hard for you to tell me Malcolm X's last name.
Malcolm X's last name.
Is it Little, Jones, Fannin, or Brown?
Mrs. Evans, I failed.
Little, Jones, Fannin, or Brown?
Jones.
His last name is Little, Mr. Hargrove. You just missed a question on an IQ test.
An IQ test?
Yes, that's right. Put together by Dr. Robert Williams, founder of the Association of Black Psychologists.
Yeah, that's the book my wife is reading from.
Well, frankly, I fail to see the importance of whether or not I know Malcolm X's last name.
Oh, what you really mean is not important to you.
This is ridiculous.
Now, look here, Mr. Hargrove. All people ain't statistics, see? I mean, you know something because you come from one culture. I know something because I come from another culture.
I felt that I had created an instrument, you know, that would speak to the whole issue of cultural bias and testing, and it did. I received over 200 critical letters from white psychologists saying that this was a racist separate test, that it should not exist, but it brought to the attention of how a test can be biased in favor of or against a particular culture. If you pull all the items from one cultural pool, that group will do better than if you pull it from someone else's cultural pool. I wanted to show that the B'nai and the WISC were culturally biased. We put out a 5-point moratorium on testing. We needed to do something about this testing with black parents so that they would stop their students from taking the test. The interesting thing about it, none of the white psychologists organizations accepted the moratorium. They continued to test. That moratorium led to the Larry P. decision out in California because black psychologists brought a suit against San Francisco school district for placing so many black students in special ed because they were using the Stanford-Binet and the Wechsler intelligence scale for children. And our black kids were flunking out. They were falling in the low average to below average range.
Some black parents had gone to the San Francisco Urban League because they were annoyed or upset that their children had been placed in special education classes for the educably mentally retarded. Educably mentally retarded, they were just children who were not functioning, who were marginally functioning in regular classes programs. And so the educably mentally retarded were kids usually above IQ of 70, and those below were the train and trainable category. So we went and talked with the officials, and it turned out that IQ scores were the basic determinant of children being placed in special education. We gathered about six of these children up and took them to this agency where we worked at Westside Community Mental Health Center. The scores that they achieved on IQ tests that we administered increased between 17 and 38 points, which meant they were totally not eligible, completely not eligible for this placement. Yet they had been tested by other psychologists and met the requirement of an IQ of below 75. And instead of being a test to determine ability to benefit from more education or do something in the area of vocational development, it became a concept where an IQ score was a permanent mark of your abilities.
The question is, really, was this destiny? In other words, are certain people supposed to do certain things in life? And should we relegate that to these people? And that psychological testing became a tool in the hands of many people to prove a point that what was going on was scientifically correct.
It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me, yeah, it's a new dawn, it's a new day.
I believe the role of a black woman is to work for a just society, the kind of a society in which children can grow up without fear, in which they can hope. Don't you think so?
Really, you know, to boil it all down, black woman is the mother of civilization. That's it. She's the mother of the earth. She bears forth fruit to fertilize the soil.
Initially, black psychology was very male-centric. It focused on black men, and it didn't contend with gender and gender differences in any critical way. There was kind of a default that blackness meant maleness. And over the past couple of decades, we've begun to correct that, to really acknowledging the impact of gender, and importantly, to acknowledging sexism.
We're not just struggling with racism, we're also struggling with sexism, patriarchal systems that have been in place and that make assumptions about men and women that aren't necessarily true. So when you start from women who are often the most poor and women who often are the most vulnerable as caretakers of children for the most part, when you start with their needs, then you ultimately deal with the needs of the family as a unit and then the community as a whole.
I define a psychology of black women and girls as a psychology that addresses the thoughts, the feelings, the experiences, the behavior of black women and girls, and that tries to make sense of and understand that in the particular context in which black women and girls live. It's a psychology that must look at the impact of race, of racial identity, of racism. It must look at the impact of gender.
You constantly are thinking, now how will this affect black women? How will this affect African women? How will this affect anyone who is dealing with the caretaking of children and the caretaking of families? By starting with women, then you ensure that the family unit and then the community unit is basically going to be safe, fed, and whole.
The girls that I work with usually come with a high level of self-esteem. The self-discovery is where I see the gap. That black girl excitement has been crushed. And I think it comes from just now being told in certain environments that they can't, they need to sit down, they're loud, they're in the way, you're disruptive, you're bossy, and they have no idea how to nurture that bold girl because now she's become the loud girl, the girl that's bossy, the girl that's in the way. So now she doesn't know what to do with that. And she's trying to kind of rediscover who she is and that self-esteem that she has. She's like been told that it's too much, that it's in the way. And now she's trying to figure that out again.
So we have to understand the importance of how we as Black women socialize Black girls. We socialize our Black girls to be androgynous, to be both independent but compassionate and caring at the same time, because that has been a survival for us as Black women. We can't be just caring and compassionate and helpless and dependent. And so we have to understand the roles that Black women have had to undertake, and also the institution of enslavement, oppression, discrimination. And in doing so, also understand that Black women have had quite a bit of resiliency. We have survived, and in many cases, we have thrived.
I think it's really important to have some focused attention on the psychology of Black women and girls because of the particular and unique history of Black girls and women in the United States. Black women have had to make very difficult decisions in very complicated contexts about when to push for freedom and liberation and when to sit tight, about when to speak up and when to shut up. And they've had to do that on behalf of themselves, but also importantly on behalf of their partners, on behalf of their children. And that context, that cauldron, has created a kind of complicated psychology for Black women.
I think that unfortunately, a lot of us, Black men and Black women, believe in the myth of that matriarchy. And I think that belief engenders a lot of negative things. Number one, it says that matriarchy is inferior to patriarchy, which is a whole thing right there. You see that patriarchy is a sort of natural or divine order of things, which is not so. Two, that Black men have believed and internalized the myth of white womanhood in this country and Anglo-Saxon impositions, so that they place us in relation to where white women are.
The most disrespected person in America is the Black woman. The most unprotected person in America is the Black woman. The most neglected person in America is the Black woman.
Shifting is a construct that has to do with the ways in which Black women change their thinking, their feeling, or their behavior in response to racial and gender bias. It speaks to all of the ways that Black women maneuver, if you will, sometimes consciously, but oftentimes unconsciously.
When I first decided that I wanted to provide a program and services for girls, specifically Black girls, the girls taught me something else. They truly told me what they needed. And it wasn't just about preparing them for etiquette classes or their culture and giving them enrichment activities. It was about the world and the narrative that they had about a Black girl. So some of the things that I even tried to change in her, I realized that was what created her to be authentic, what made her different and unique and lovable and funny and joyous. And I wanted to nurture all of that, but also make sure that the world didn't see that everything that a Black girl does is not a bad thing. We are preparing Black girls for the world and the world for Black girls. Because one thing that I have learned from over a decade of working with girls is that they already know what they need. The wisdom lives inside of them. As long as they have infrastructure, mentorship, and resources, they could build what they need, not only to survive, but to thrive.
And as Black women, we have to be the inspiration for the nation, for our men. We have to start out into the community educating the children, educating ourselves. Because once we educate ourselves, the children will become educated because we are the ones that teach the children. We are the ones that are with both female and male children. We are the ones that the children look to as the image in terms of their daily education. And we don't get our values mixed up and feel that we have to educate the world. We haven't first educated ourselves. It's still always a self thing. I mean, the world will relate to us once we can relate to ourselves.
The syndrome of the strong Black women embodies independence, well-being, resiliency, sometimes even racial and ethnic pride. It also embodies characteristics like suppression of emotions, feeling like you have to have multiple roles. Overall, it may be functional at some point, but the negative health consequences are showing up. Because you know if you are not regulating your emotions, it's going to have some physiological effects on your body.
They have sucked us dry. That we have nursed the children, we have fed them, we have done everything, put all our energies, all our work into working for the white family. And now it's time for us to take all our strength. You know, we're supposed to be the strongest woman anyway. It's time for us to take all our strength, all our milk, all of that, and put it into working for the Black nation.
Black psychology is liberation psychology for Black people, with the understanding that once people of African descent are free, everyone's free. A Black feminist psychology builds upon Black psychology and liberation psychology by making clear that when we take care of women's needs, then we're already taking care of the needs of children. And then we're freeing men as well to be who they are. We are simply looking at the needs of women in order to better address the needs of children and men. And so it frees both men and women from the rigid definitions of what it means to be a man and what it means to be a woman. And it moves us to a level of basically, what does it mean to be human?
So I think the psychology has evolved in paying more attention to those, to that array of intersections, looking beyond simply race and gender and addressing some of the other factors that impact people's sense of self, well-being, and behavior.
You see, we are human beings. And we are not stopping now till we get something that's better. We worked all these years for nothing. Women have gone to the field and worked from 10 to 12 hours for $3 a day. Those things are wrong, and we mean to right them by standing up.
Ultimate liberation, freeing of the African mind.
All right.
One of the things that we need to be clear about is that we have been trying desperately to get free ever since we've been here.
All right.
There has never been a period in our experience in North America that we haven't been trying to somehow gain liberation, to get freedom, to get away from the oppressive restrictions on our humanity that this culture has enforced.
We can't just ignore racism, white supremacy. It's here. It is the power context. I mean, the system is not structured for the maximal development of the Black genetic and constitutional potential. I mean, this is what we're told. We're told to believe this is a democracy and everybody's equal. Everybody has equal opportunity. But I say that that's a myth. What exists is a system which is for white survival and for the inferiorization of Black people. And this is what we have had for 500 years.
I think Fanon made some very major contributions to Black psychology. You know, the focus on oppression and discrimination. I think what was very appealing about that is that, you know, here you have this Black psychiatrist from Martinique who's spending time in Algeria, writing about race, racism, discrimination, oppression, and its impact on our psyches, on our collective psyches, right? Frantz Fanon never had been to Indianola, Mississippi, but the model that he wrote about applied so clearly and cleanly in this context that I could understand why people would really grasp onto books like Black Skin, White Mask. In terms of contemporary psychology, I don't think that we have really studied Fanon outside of nationalist circles to the extent that we probably should and could have, because a lot of his work has very strong implications for health psychology, for behavioral medicine, for community psychology. But because he's a psychiatrist and is affiliated more with medicine, a lot of people in psychological circles don't even know who Fanon is.
The 10-point program. Number one, we want freedom. We want the power to control the destiny of our black communities. Number two, we want full employment for our people. Number three, we want an end to the robbery by the white man of our black communities. Number four, we want decent housing fit to shelter human beings. Number five, we want education for our people that teaches us the true nature of this decadent American society. Education that teaches us our true history and our role in the present day society. Number six, we want all black men to be exempt from military service. Number seven, we want an immediate end to police brutality and murder of black people. Number eight, we want all black people to be released from the many prisons, city, county, and state jails that they are now being held in. Number nine, we want all black people, when brought to court, to be tried by a jury of their peers or people from their black communities as defined in the Constitution. Number 10, we want land, justice, housing, education, clothing, and peace. And as a major political objective, a United Nations supervised plebiscite to be held throughout the black colonies of America, in which only black people will participate to decide or determine the will of black people as to their national destiny.
Right on, brother. Right on.
Racism is a system for people who classify themselves as white once they realize that they were a tiny minority on the planet and that they were genetic recessive. The majority of the people on the planet, black, brown, red, and yellow, are genetically dominant to white people. In other words, if you mix white and black, you're going to get a colored person, not another white person.
My mother is African American and my father is European American.
I'm African-American and Caucasian.
I'm a quarter Filipino, a quarter African-American, Irish, Scottish, English, Dutch, French, German, and Navajo Indian.
And because they are minority and genetic recessive on this particular planet, where the majority people are people of color, if they're going to genetically survive, they have to be in charge. They have to be able to control everybody. They have to be able to kill at will.
The deliberate and systematic destruction of a group's mind with the ultimate aim, the ultimate objective being the extirpation or the extermination of that group. That's menticide. This deliberate and systematic destruction of a group's mind with the ultimate objective being the extermination of that group.
And this is what we are experiencing, a system that is interested in its genetic survival and is fearful of other people being genetically dominant to itself, then the logical outcome is genocide. White genetic survival necessitates genocide for black and other people of color. And this is what we have happening.
Why are we like we are? It's very simple. We are in a race war. And we are the only one who don't know it. Not only that we the only one don't know it, we the only one don't even know what race we are. Seriously, give us a thought. Don't laugh about it. We are in a race war, and we refuse to accept it.
The other thing I'm surprised at is we keep being surprised. When we keep thinking that this is some new initiative. I mean, the violence initiative began with our enslavement and continues today. We already have fought the violence initiative, ladies and gentlemen. It is already operating. We bought it when we bought learning disabilities, when we bought the concept of hyperactivity, when we bought the concept of impulsivity, when we bought the concept of special education. You're already in it.
I think it's interesting when we refer to Bobby Wright and Amos Wilson as radical black psychologists. And I often wonder, well, what makes them so radical? Both of them were just brilliant minds. And I think if there's anything that's radical about them, I think it's the extent to which they really valued education. and to the extent to which they were really, you know, willing to put everything on the line to, you know, make this scholarly position that we have work for the community. You know, Bobby Wright has a book, The Psychopathic Racial Personality, to say that white people are psychopathic. If we look at the history of their relations with African people, white people have been psychopathic. Is that really radical? I think Bobby Wright's main contribution was that he used a lot of the concepts and theoretical frameworks in the traditional psychology and pointed out their inadequacies and their contradictions. And then he filled that void with, you know, his vision of like how those contradictions should be filled in ways that would perpetuate the mental health of African people. Bobby Wright was associated with, at the time, the Garfield Park Comprehensive Mental Health Center, which now bears his name. That's an aspect of his work that often gets understated because, you know, in this age of technology, we have YouTube videos and, you know, we can read his books, but we don't think about the fact that Bobby Wright actually sat in a clinic and gave therapy to clients. Amos Wilson had this very, you know, acerbic wit about him to make these points very clearly and cogently and concisely, but also keeping in mind what the broader picture is. And the broader picture for Amos Wilson was always liberation and power.
White Americans have a criminal history. They have a criminal nation. The nation is built on criminality and murder and exploitation. It is a part of their collective psyche. The United States is a mafia government. No one has done more damage and degradation and murder, rape, and robbery than Europeans. Yes. Therefore, in order to escape confrontation with their true criminal nature, they must accuse others of being criminals. What we call projection. They must become obsessed with the criminality of other people. And black folk become those other people, you see.
You know, his magnum opus, The Blueprint for Black Power, is, you know, perhaps a book that no one trained in psychology could write by themselves. But the fact that he did it really exemplifies the breadth of his knowledge, the depth of his knowledge, and the extent to which he understood how to apply these different social and political theories and frameworks into principles that could help to, you know, improve the situation of black people.
That's the function of stereotyping, you see. If I call you a criminal, then I can treat you what? Criminally. I don't owe you justice. In fact, shooting you in the street is justice. We know you are already a criminal. Why should we bother to take you to trial? Yes, that's what it is. We're doing a service. We're saving the taxpayers' money. What have we lost? A criminal? What are you complaining about? Yeah. This is the deal. What does it mean then? In order to escape certain problems, become obsessed with other issues to the point where they don't have time or the energy or anything else to think about anything else. They don't see anything else.
The only way that physical enslavement would work is that the mind also had to be enslaved. And there were a series of processes that I call the dynamics of domination. That in order for one group of people, in this case Europeans, to control an African population, it was necessary first to erase African memory. Secondly, to suppress the practice of African culture. Third, to teach white supremacy. Fourth, to control the institution of socialization to prevent African people from educating their own children, from sending their own messages and so forth through media and what have you, the control of wealth, and finally, physical segregation. These are the historical activities mm-hmm. that Europeans engaged in order to conquer the continent, to enslave people, to practice segregation. And of course, if you look closely at that list, you'll notice that the first few things on the list are really psychological.
Asa Hilliard's status in black psychology is, in my opinion, nothing short of legendary. being an educational psychologist, he's part of this historical lineage. Asa Hilliard continued that historical legacy. But what he also did, you know, with his connections with folks like Naeem Akbar, Kobe Cambone, Wade Nobles, he took it back to Kemet as well. And so in Asa Hilliard, I think you get a person who understands our immediate history, but also who understood our distal history.
Well, the ultimate objective is to force a truthful rendition of the human experience. In other words, we must know what the truth is about humanity so that we can know what the truth is about ourselves, so that we can be not just feeling good about ourselves, but that we can become whole people.
Now, I don't know who the next person who has, you know, that depth of knowledge and that commitment to African-centered principles and African-centered scholarship. I don't know who that person is who can make it as relevant to our current situation as Asa Hilliard did.
Cultural unity is equal to political unity and economic power. The goal is unity and resurrection.
And liberation.
And liberation. Well, liberation mm-hmm. for resurrection. Mm-hmm. As a people, not just as individual. I think it's important for our people to be strong again.
Our most radical voices, I think, appeared in the late 70s, mid 80s, and then again in the early 90s. We need a new generation of radical psychologists who are able to revisit some of these concepts, these theoretical frameworks, these constructs, and help push us forward to the development of new paradigms.
Part of our notion of trying to reclaim African psychology has been to wrestle with the fundamental question about not only what it means to be human, but what it means to be authentically Black, and what is the best way to achieve liberation, which all of us want, even as we traverse that landscape between the ideas of a more orthodox African-centered scholar and the ones who are probably less orthodox in terms of their African-centeredness, but no less Black, who fight on probably a different front, but whose ideas, I think, are equally valuable.
What our job is in African psychology is to further develop those daimonic methods. They are practiced on a regular basis in the cultural traditions of traditional medicine in Africa, but we have not done the legwork to figure out how to translate that to the kind of work that's done in the academy in the development of the discipline of African psychology.
I think one of the things that's going to be our primary challenge is trying to figure out how do we make African-centered theoretical frameworks and conceptual principles relevant in the type of psychological science, you know, or research that we do. I think with, individuals like a Kobe Cambone or Naeem Akbar and Asa Hilliard, that they were very good at laying out theoretical concepts and framework. But what hasn't happened is that they haven't passed the baton to people who are going to advance their work. I'm not sure of what it would take in order to advance that work, but that's a problem that we really have to find a solution for and find a solution very quickly.
We need to also do the work of bringing ourselves together across the diaspora to understand what does this mean and what does this look like for a Pan-African understanding of African psychology. So we're going to have to figure out how we convene ourselves to begin to have the Pan-African dialogue so that this is a psychology that reflects the diaspora and that can speak to our common experience and our unique circumstances.
So the work of Black psychologists is to ensure that people who went through 246 years of enslavement have at least some possibility of a correct path, a path of mot, based on us working with the mind and working with the mind in an African sense. I think it's essential that Black psychologists do that. But I think that Black psychologists also have another job, a job of defending the African people from all notions of supremacy, from anyone. This means that you have to ferret out all examples where there is white supremacy attempting to undermine a Black personality.
And so we have to move so as to replace the system of racism, white supremacy with a system of justice. And in the process, making the decision or determination that we are going to maximally develop ourselves.
To the degree that we can create a more broad-based institutional infrastructure that has this African-centered content, that's the degree to which we will be able to restore this normalcy, this psychodynamic of normalcy within the African-American personality.
I think if we can come to the place where we can really begin to interrogate what does it mean to be fully human and what is humanity in a sustainable structure and system of functioning, what we do now is not sustainable. The only thing that's going to be sustainable is when we move to justice.
Citizens of Africa, I greet you in the name of the Universal Negro Movement Association and African Communities League of the World. You may ask, what organization is that? It is for me to inform you that the Universal Negro Movement Association is an organization that seeks to unite into one solid body the 400 million Negroes of the world, the link of the 50 million Negroes of the United States of America, to the 20 million Negroes of the West Indies, the 40 million Negroes of South and Central America, to the 280 million Negroes of Africa, for the purpose of bettering our industrial, commercial, educational, social, and political conditions. As you are aware, the world in which we live today is divided into separate race groups and distinct nationalities. Each race and each nationality is endeavoring to work out its own destiny to the exclusion of other races and other nationalities. We hear the cry of England for the Englishman, of France for the Frenchman, of Germany for the German, of Ireland for the Irish, of Palestine for the Jews, of Japan for the Japanese, of China for the Chinese. We of the Universal Negro Movement Association are raising the cry of Africa for the Africans, those at home and those abroad. There are 400 million Africans in the world who have Negro blood coursing through their veins. And we believe that the time has come to unite these 400 million people for the one common purpose of bettering their conditions. The great struggle of the Negro for the last 500 years has been battled in unity. No one or no organization ever succeeded in uniting the Negro race. But within the last 4 years, the Universal Negro Movement Association has worked wonders in bringing together in one fold 4 million organized Negroes who are scattered in all parts of the world. In the 48 states of the American Union, all over the United States, and the country of South and Central America and Africa. These 4 million people are working to convert the rest of the 400 million scattered all over the world. And it is for this purpose that we are asking you to join our ranks and do the best you can to help us to bring about an emancipated race. If anything praiseworthy is to be done, it must be done through unity. And it is for that reason that the Universal Negro Movement Association calls upon every Negro in the United States to rally to this standard. We want to unite the Negro race in this country. We want every Negro to work for one common object, that of building a nation of his own on the great continent of Africa. That all Negroes all over the world are working for this common system of government in Africa.